第37队演讲的题目是 Number Three， 计时开始。
Dear honorable judges, if we have friends from the target nation of our new southbound policy come to stay in Taiwan for 2 nights and 3 days, we will design a trip that is full of adventures, delicacies, and friendship. During the trip, we'll introduce Taiwan's characteristics.Including modern development, insightful tourist attraction, and unique culture. We want to make this trip as rewarding and as unforgettable as possible, and to bring bilateral understanding and cooperation opportunities along. First, Jack will start the first day, adventurous local tour. Anna will talk about Taiwan's delicacies soup for all, and last but not least,Peggy will introduce you how to bond with our visitors.
Thank you, Nia. Shall we start our adventure? Visiting the capital of a nation we believe will be the most irreplaceable arrangement. So at first, we will take our friends to join the Taipei walking tour. This tour is especially designed for foreign visitors who wish to explore the local culture like a runner, stroller, and feet. Instead of taking any kind of transportation,Taipei Walking Tour will guide our friends to visit small alleys and narrow streets, venture local markets, and peek into common people's lives. Special topics of walking can also be chosen based on Taipei's different traits, such as Temple Walking Tour, Old Town Taipei, and Hunger Game. Yes, that's right, a tour to a night market. This budgeted but insightful guided tour.Will introduce the most detailed but casual way to know about Taiwan. Taipei Walking Tour will surely impress our friends with refreshingly imprinted experiences. Next, Anna will introduce the thing loved by all, Taiwan's delicacies.
Thank you, Jack. When it comes to the food in Taiwan, the variety of delicacies often impress the tourists from around the world.Did you know, our government is also trying to promote the burgeoning halal food market. Our friends from the new southbound nations, of course, will take delight in a wide range of cuisine. In Taiwan, we especially want to enhance the business opportunities in the Muslim world. More and more local restaurants have been actively courting Muslim tourists by creating a hospitable environment. Also,Asia's Super 5-in-1 International Food Festival will take place during June 21-24, 2018. It will feature top quality food commodities, food related technologies, and catered equipment. We are sharing the integration of Taiwan's famous food industry and halal approved food manufacturers will make this trip an unforgettable experience. Last,We would like to invite Peggy to talk about the international bonding and friendship.
Thank you, Anna. For our friends from target nations of the new southbound policy, the last stop we should never miss is the opportunity to strongly bond our friendship. In Taiwan's middle schools and universities alike, there is a prevalence of sister schools in cooperation with US school, Canadian school, and Japanese school.Seldom do we sign contracts with schools from new southbound countries. And thus young people in Taiwan still possess little knowledge, if not zero of them. Our last stop will be visiting Taiwan's educational institutions to promote language learning and social exchange. For example, the immigrants from new southbound countries and their second generation will be the best ambassador facilitating mutual communication and understanding. All in all, we hope that the adventurous guided tour, the pampering of the test bud, and the bounty of the visitors in Taiwan will impress our international friends and bring a long future opportunity.
Thank you,
Brian. 第35队演讲的题目是 Number Five.计时开始。
Southeast Asia is the major source of new immigrants,
Thanks, Livia. As young people, we could have two things to do. First, we should better our language ability. English is, of course, the top priority. It is also popular to learn South Asian country languages. There are a lot of high schools now offer students the chances to learn South Asian country languages. If we have a better language ability, then we can broaden our minds by visiting our friends we invite from South Asian countries. Students nowadays are more likely to travel abroad when they're young, in the age of 16. It is much easier for lay to get the understanding of the world. In this way, we will have a better global vision.
Thank you, James. The way of talking or eating all delegates our country, Taiwan. Meanwhile, learning the new southbound policy is intended. Southern Asia travelers will come to Taiwan, and the economy of Taiwan will surely grow. The Taiwanese government will have the tourism subsidy from the Southern Asia travelers. And maybe it's our chance to let Taiwan grow and let the economy grow. We'll upgrade the economy.
第33队演讲的题目是 Number 4, 计时开始。
The first wave of international migration observed in Taiwan dates back to the 1960s. It was once in a lifetime opportunity for many young and talented university students to study abroad and to take home with them what they have learned. This migration phenomenon was also observed in the business world.Taiwanese businesses began to invest in regions such as Central America and Southeast Asia. The first generation of international students and corporates did not have any predecessors to talk to or to seek advice from. They were on their own, yet they were optimistic and adventurous. These qualities were passed down from generation to generation. The young generation today, like many others,is living in an increasingly globalized world. The ability to move around the world and the ability to handle global affairs are an essential skill in navigating today's world. There are three things that the young generation can do to increase their international mobility and their ability to handle international affairs.First, the young generation must
must develop critical reasoning. Critical reasoning requires one to apply logic and reason to all information presented. Legend has it that young George Washington chopped down his father's cherry tree. And when confronted by his father, George Washington admitted that he did chop down his father's cherry tree. When his father saw how honest his son was, he hugged his son and burst into tears. The story was meant to teach us the virtue of honesty. But what if the story was meant to teach us the virtue of power? Think about this. Would you hit your son if your son had hatred on his hand?
Second, the young generation must broaden their worldview. One way to do this is by traveling. But is there another option? The answer is yes, and in fact, many. The Model United Nations, commonly known as MUN, is a popular choice. The Model United Nations provides students the opportunity to participate in global affairs and examine global politics from a national standpoint. To complement the training of MUN, students are encouraged to take courses in philosophy. Global politics are rooted in political thoughts developed by philosophical figures such as Plato, Machiavelli, and John Locke. Third, the young generation must develop high emotional intelligence. Although traits such as IQ and technical skills are important, research shows that EQ is an essential element in leadership and is a key factor that separates outstanding performers from average performers.
The future belongs to everyone. However, if you don't work hard at present, the future will slip away. The younger generation needs to combine the positive traits they've inherited from the previous generation with new tools to navigate today's community. The younger generation needs to combine the positive traits they've inherited from the previous generation with new tools to navigate today's community. The previous generation provided tools and construct building blocks for our younger generation. And now, it's our turn to give back to the community and create new building blocks for our future generation. We hope you all have enjoyed today's speech. Until next time.
Thank you.
第31队演讲的题目是 Number 5, 计时开始。
Good morning.
Since the inauguration of President Tsai Ing-wen, the government has been working hard to revitalize Taiwan's economy and enhance the relationship with its neighboring countries. One of these policies is the new southbound policy, which aims to get rid of dependence on a specific single market. The target nations of this policy include Southeast and South Asian countries, Australia and New Zealand. Though these countries are not far away from Taiwan, they have different traits. Among these countries, we would like to talk about Association of Southeast Asian Nations, referred to as ASEAN, because it is the region where we have trade most and interact frequently. Nowadays, even the powerful countries have begun to pay attention to ASEAN because of its astonishing economic growth.
ASEAN is an organization inclusive of 10 Southeast nations. These 10 countries have become a zero-tariff economic system since 2015, turning these decentralized countries into a single market. since 2005, the economic growth rate per year of ASEAN has reached 5%. And it even goes beyond America, Japan, and the European Union. At the year of 2015, it became the largest economic system in the world after the European Union. According to the statistics of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, there are 6 countries of ASEAN coming into the top 15 trading partners of Taiwan. Nevertheless, the internet industry in Indonesia, a country of ASEAN, has gradually grown recently. The population of the internet users in Indonesia rises to 100 million in 2016. This is undoubtedly good news for Taiwan because we have a flourishing electronic industry. In short, ASEAN is not only an organization full of possibility and potentiality, but also a region having a strong influence on the future world.
As for young people, a lot of us may consider it useless to participate in national policy. However, this may be a misconception. For instance, young people can read some books about the culture of the target nations, learn the native languages of the new southbound countries, or travel to those countries by themselves. In addition, we can also share some of our traveling experiences or something special with our friends. In this way, more people can have a better understanding of them and be more familiar with those countries. Our school has a sister school in Singapore. To ensure that friendship can last, our school hosts a study tour to Singapore every summer vacation. I believe only by interacting directly can we have a better understanding with each other. I really broadened my horizons after taking part in the activity. From the experience, I have learned something that I can never get from the textbook. I believe if our target nations know we are learning their cultures and customs, we will have a better chance to cooperate with them both in culture and in academy.
The implementation of the new Southbound policy has started. The main goal of promoting it is to contribute to regional peace and economy and social development, as well as to create a sense of community among all the nations of this region. This can only be done by building closer links between Taiwan and the new southbound countries. Young people actually play a very important part. Try to think about that. Human beings won't be young permanently. Those who are the leaders in Taiwan now will become the elders in the future. Therefore, there is no denying that the younger generation is the crucial group of the society. To achieve the goal, we still have a long way to go. Apart from the government, I believe most of the people are able to promote this policy through interacting in person.
Let's devote ourselves to the bright future together. Thank you.
第30队演讲的题目是 Number 1, 计时开始.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. When talking about Taiwan's features, what comes to your mind? Most people would think about our temple culture, Jade Mountain, night market, or our friendly people. But the most practical and important thing is actually hidden in our everyday life. Most of us are used to a convenient lifestyle, but I think this is our most outstanding feature to promote to the world. We have more than 10,000 convenience stores in Taiwan, and they are open for 24 hours. There is a multiple media kiosk in every single convenience store in Taiwan. You can buy tickets, pay bills, or print documents on this machine. In addition, there are some special public equipment in our cities. U-Bike, U-Motor, and U-Car are services where you can rent vehicles with a low price. After setting up your smart card from the machine beside the bike stop, you can rent a bike by scanning the sensor on the card. It's so easy that people of all ages like how does a foreigner really feel while staying in Taiwan? Janice would tell you a true story about it.
Thank you, Eva. David, one of my friends, is a true Aussie that had never been to a foreign country. During this past summer vacation, he had his first foreign trip, and he took it to Taiwan. We took him to the east side of Taiwan, Hualien. During our trip, we did many other activities. He was satisfied with our planning, but the only thing he was worried about was running out of cash. In Australia, it's hard to find an ATM in the suburbs, but in Taiwan, where convenience is key, David found convenience store everywhere, even on the mountain. He told me this is the most impressive thing he experienced in Taiwan. When he was on his way to Taoyuan Airport, the Taiwan high-speed rail surprised him a lot. Every day, there are about 140 runs between the north and south, shortening the time of going from Kaohsiung to Taipei into 1.5 hours. Since high-tech transportation had never been seen in his life, his trip to Taiwan widened his view of what a convenient life really is. I think the other foreigners will feel the same as he did. Talking about our transportation, Cindy is going to share her research to you.
Thank you, Janice. The bus in Taiwan is much cheaper than many other countries, and the bus stop and shift are more intensive than you think. There is a contactless market system called EasyCard that you can deposit money in it and buy things in convenience stores or take bus or train. Joanne, a Taiwanese blogger, wrote an article about how this feature surprised her French husband. In the article, her husband said that in this country, taking a bus to a nearby town cost at least 2 euros. But in Taiwan, he found the price to be much cheaper. What's more, she also mentioned that our night market is another important element of our convenient lifestyles. Night market opens until midnight, and stores in night market sell necessities or cheap clothes, toys, and games. But the most important one is the food store. There are many kinds of Taiwan street food, like Brisbane rice, oyster omelette, bubble tea, and much more. Night market food was so popular, it was mentioned in a CNN article about Taiwanese fast food and drinks. According to the article, food is serious, is respected, is all excellent in Taiwan. In addition to the convenience of night markets, Taiwan also combines food and technology together. But how? Tina will share with you.
Thank you, Cindy. We have many apps related to food, like EasyTable, iCook, iPeep, and more. EasyTable is a booking app that you can book over 10,000 restaurants without calling them. In just one click, you can easily enjoy popular restaurants without spending time in line. After dining, you can comment on the restaurant and share your experience on the app. Another app called iCook is a famous app for people who love to cook. You can share your recipes and check out other people's recipes. After listening about how convenient Taiwan is and the real foreign tourist experience, you surely know how unique we are. We definitely have to believe that we have the ability to surprise the world. Ladies,
thank you.
第29队演讲的题目是 Number Q， 计时开始。
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, honorable judges. Due to globalization and the rapidly improving technology in recent years, the world has been more close-knit. The boundaries separating countries and people have become less distinct. Unlike the past, people find it easy to meet and connect with others who come from a vastly different background. this has led to a rise in a group of people called the global citizens, who have a sense of belonging not only to their country, but also to the world community. They possess cultural sensitivity and strive to learn more about other cultures. At the same time, they retain their own beliefs but are empathetic and understanding of others.
This is where international etiquette comes into play. It is the basis of global citizenship. A global citizen should be able to develop and maintain relationships with people from different backgrounds. Having good international etiquette is the first step to developing a quality relationship. Without sufficient cultural awareness in regard to the appropriate etiquette, one could accidentally offend the other person and have their relationship permanently damaged in the process. Etiquette such as appropriate hand gestures and touching might look trivial to people from one culture, but may actually be quite significant to the other person. Having good international etiquette will help you avoid embarrassing situations.
Global citizens are also likely to be future global leaders, sold out by various businesses. Some might be global leaders in businesses. Some might be diplomats speaking for their own country. As global businesses continue to expand and bring people closer, the most important element of successful business outcome might be the appreciation and respect for country and cultural differences. Etiquette serves as a medium in conveying respect. One cannot be a global leader with terrible international etiquette. From an ethical perspective, a trait that defines global citizens is their ability to understand how their actions can affect people from different backgrounds and take responsibility for things they do.
Etiquette is one of the strongest indicators of global citizenship. Etiquette is an aspect of culture. No matter how much you know about global affairs or how many countries you have traveled to before, if you have a bad etiquette, you will never be a global citizen. Having proper etiquette is crucial to become a true global citizen. Having etiquette creates great first impressions and develop, build relationship, and most importantly, to convey an understanding. A kiss on the cheeks or shaking hands are both significant but important etiquette. We need to stand up as a global citizen to have proper international etiquette to be one of the global citizens in the ever-changing world.
Number 2, 计时开始.
Honorable judges, good morning. Etiquette is about building relationship with others. It is not about rules and regulations, but it's about providing basic social comfort and creating an environment where others feel comfortable and secure. This is possible through better communication. Etiquette consists of two things. Firstly, thoughtful consideration of the interest and feeling with others. Secondly, being able to minimize misunderstanding. Etiquette differs from region to region and from country to country, and it's important for both social business interactions. And now, our teammate Ryan is going to talk about the first example of how international etiquette is.
Thank you, Andre. Punctuality and time are received differently in many different cultures, so knowing the local time is very important. For example, in the States, they follow the strict time schedule. Therefore, being on time is very important. In Latin America and Africa, time is not important. In Middle Eastern countries, power is shown by being late. Now, in these countries, there's an expectation that you will be late. So, in Tanzania, it's polite for you to be 15 to 30 minutes late. In Mexico, it's polite for you to be late to a meeting or a party, as the host may feel rushed or insulted if they are caught unprepared. Now, my teammate Edwin is going to be talking about another example.
Thank you, Ryan. Flowers. Flowers are seen as an all-purpose gift. They are given as graduations, funerals, apologies, or get-well gifts. Although flowers are a universal gift, misunderstandings can occur if you don't understand the local custom. For example, carnations. Carnations are seen as an all-purpose gift, and they're given as graduations and funerals. Although carnations are a common cemetery decoration in Germany and France, to give someone a bouquet of white flower or a carnation friends may interpret as saying drop dead. Yellow flowers are bad luck in Italy and Brazil, and purple flowers are hate in Russia and Iran. Now my teammate Eddie is going to talk about another example.
Thank you, Edwin. Touching and shaking hands are also seen differently. A few years ago, Prince William and his wife Kate visited America and went to watch an NBA game. After the game, they had a picture taken with a famous basketball player, LeBron James. However, LeBron James put his hand on Princess Kate's shoulder while taking the picture. In England, it's touching the body of anyone of the royal family is considered improper behavior. LeBron James later stated that it was a great honor to have the royal couple watch his game. However, he didn't know that it was a taboo for people to touch the body of the royal family, except shaking hands. In America, it's natural to hug or even kiss people when they meet for the first time. He was very sorry that he didn't understand the international etiquette and didn't mean to be rude. Now, our teammate Ryan is going to do the conclusion.
Thank you, Eddie. From these examples, we can see that many different countries have different ways of thinking and acting. Therefore, knowing the international etiquette is very important. As a global teenager and a citizen, we should be respectful to different customs and cultures. Our goal should always be to make others feel comfortable and secure.
Thank you. 第23队演讲的题目是 Number 3, 计时开始.
Honorable judges, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. In this global village, people have started to travel much more frequently. Now, if you have a chance to plan a trip for your Southeast Asian friends to Taiwan, where would you take them to? Which way would you choose to present this beautiful island to your friends? Maybe our unrivaled travel package will give you some inspiration. Culture is what we'll focus on in this package because we want our friends to experience the charm of Taiwan on their own. And this is the easiest way. Just come with us, then you'll see. Next, Cindy will start with the first day of our travel package in northern Taiwan. Cindy.
Thank you, Shani. On the first day, we will be visiting Fort San Domingo, the National Palace Museum, and Shiling Night Market. Fort San Domingo is an ancient castle built in 1629 when Taiwan was colonized by the Spanish. It is a great place to learn of Taiwan's early colonial history. Continuing on to the National Palace Museum, we can get a glimpse of both China and and Taiwan's incredible history. After an afternoon learning about the past, we can spend an evening exploring Taiwan's vibrant culture of today. Shilin Night Market is a great example of Taiwan's favorite nighttime activity. Our night markets showcase Taiwan's favorite snacks, such as the shaved ice with mango, boba milk tea, and of course, sticky tofu. There's so much more than food too, with a lot of games, activities, clothes, and souvenirs available for very low prices. Isn't it a great place to end your day? Next, Molly is going to tell us about the second day in Central Taiwan. Molly.
Thank you, Cindy. On the second day, we plan to visit Dajia Zhenlan Temple and Sun Moon Lake. Dajia Zhenlan Temple is over 200 years old and is dedicated to Taiwan's most worshipped gods. Mazu is an important goddess that protects the fishermen to sell safely. To thank her, we have a magnificent event called the Mazu Pilgrimage. It is also the world's third biggest religious ceremony. In the third lunar month every year, over 100,000 believers from all over Taiwan make up a massive group to follow the pilgrimage from Dajia Zhenlan Temple to Newport Mukden Palace and all the way back. After visiting the temple, our next stop will be at Sun Moon Lake. You can not only see the glorious scenery there, but also learn about another of Taiwan's characteristics, the indigenous people. Those people who live around the lake are called Shaozu. Legend says they went to the lake because they were chasing a white deer. There are so many great stories that make Sun Moon Lake as interesting as it is beautiful. Next, Sarah will tell us about the third day of our travel package in southern Taiwan. Sarah.
Thank you, Molly. And on our third day, we will visit Tian Liao Song Temple and the Pier 2 Art Center. The Tian Liao Song Temple is special, not just because of its beauty, which reminds many people of the Spanish architect Antoni Gaudi, but also because it was made by foreign workers from Southeast Asia. When the construction project they were working on went bankrupt, the workers were stranded in Taiwan. Fortunately, the monk took them in and provided for them. In return for his kindness, they constructed this beautiful temple from coral, stones, and shells. Some would argue that the Pier 2 Art Center is not so pretty to look at, but it hides a beauty of its own on the inside. The art center is repurposed from abandoned warehouses, but after a group of artists moved in, it has become an area of bohemian creativity and the soul of visual art in Kaohsiung. With the closing of our third day, we hope our friends will be happy and appreciative of Taiwan's art and see the value in working together as our workers and monks have done. Back to you, Shani.
Thank you, Sarah. After learning about Taiwan's history, religion, art, bustling nightlife, and natural beauty, we hope that people will come to love our amazing little island. And perhaps we can learn about what makes our country amazing as well. Diplomacy between countries isn't just a government issue. All the civilians, even teenagers like us, can make a contribution through tourism industry. And by just being a good host for our friends, one person at a time, we can help to forge stronger friendship with our neighbors and showcase the beauty and culture of our Formosa. Thank you.
The 20-day演讲的题目是 Number 2, 计时开始.
The Oxford Dictionary defines the word etiquette as the customary code of polite behavior in society, or among members of a particular profession or group. Simple, right? Perhaps not. Etiquette governs how we interact with those around us, with variants depending on age, status, occasion. It dictates the dinner table, telling us how to sit, what to eat, when to eat, and even how to chew. In our own countries, sometimes knowing the do's and don'ts in any given situation is challenging enough, let alone on the global level. However, irrespective of its difficulty, the importance of this customary code
cannot be understated. Daisy?
Thank you, Vicky. Let's examine a hypothetical dinner party of international guests. The party hosted by an Argentinian and attended by a Japanese, a British, an Iranian, a Moroccan, and a Ukrainian is a disaster from the get-go. Not knowing it is customary to show up an hour late to an Argentine dinner, and thinking that they're being polite, all the guests show up on time. The Moroccan guest places a bouquet of 7 flowers to lighten the mood of the clearly flustered Argentinian. This upsets the Ukrainian because an odd number of flowers symbolizes death. Shortly after, when everyone sits around the table, the Brit pours himself a drink, and in doing so, offends the Japanese who would never dream of pouring her own drink before everyone else's. Finally, dinner is served, and the Brit, who is used to silent eating, watches in disgust as the Japanese slurps down her noodles as loudly as possible. Meanwhile, the Moroccan can hardly hold his stomach watching one of the guests eating with her left hand, a hand which should be reserved for the bathroom. Noticing the Iranian hadn't said much and not realizing that this gesture is the equivalent of the middle finger, the guest offered him a reassuring thumbs up. Offended, disheartened, and confused, the guests go home. Stephen?
Thank you, Daisy. To avoid falling victim to this game of international etiquette, preparation and open-mindedness are key. If you are traveling abroad for any reason, some research is essential. Learning how to greet people, how to show respect, and learning some short phrases would demonstrate some effort had been made and may leave a lasting impression. Particular care and attention should be taken with anything involving business, family, religion, or the deceased, as these delicate areas are dealt with differently around the world. On top of this, expect the unexpected. Regardless of your knowledge, there will almost always be something that catches you off guard. And when you do make a blunder, know that it's not the end of the world and that politeness is a cure which transcends borders. Lastly, if you're hosting foreigners in your country, be open-minded. If one of your guests does something which you find unusual or even slightly offensive, try to be understanding. It may be helpful to inform the guest to save him or her from any future embarrassment. Sherry?
Thank you, Stephen. In conclusion, international etiquette is interesting, humorous, infuriating, and unavoidably embarrassing. And understanding its value can make a difference between a good memory and a bad one. Our government has made it a priority to increase Taiwan's international presence, particularly with our South and Southeast Asian neighbors. Many different countries with many languages and customs. It might be a good idea to prepare to use some international etiquette soon, both as hosts and as guests.
第十八段的演讲题目是 Number One， 计时开始。
Like a parent speaking about their child, it's easy to say good things about your own country. However, even an objective observer would have to agree that Taiwan has a lot to offer to the international world due to its many standout qualities. It's home to a robust tech and manufacturing scene.That's become important for products all around the world. Transportation here is super convenient, so much so that many don't even own a car. The location of the island is just right to grow some of the most diverse fruit in the world. Food is abundant and affordable as well. But what really makes Taiwan stand out is the friendliness, hospitality,ingenuity of the Taiwanese people.
Ladies
people think of Taiwan, it brings to mind images of a factory for the world. There was once a time when American children thought Taiwan was a place filled with fun and games, since many of their toys were labeled Made in Taiwan. But in recent years, the country has grown beyond this label. There are companies like Acer, Asus, and HTC that don't just build products for other companies, but produce products of their own. Their computers and phones can be found around the world, from the US and Canada, all the way to India and China. That new Google Pixel smartphone that so many people like is actually made by HTC. And those new and latest iPhones that people stand in line for days to get? If you had the pleasure to look inside one, you might find some important tech from TSMC, the Taiwan-based company. There's a small company called Gogoro who's pushing new ideas of how we think about the future of transportation by producing an electric-powered scooter.
Speaking of transportation, Taiwan is one of the most convenient places to get around. The government has built a robust network of buses, trains, highways, and even bike sharing programs. The major benefit of these infrastructure systems is using one card, you can board buses, trains, and rapid transit island-wide. Did I mention this is a country that has a high-speed rail? For just a little extra money, the HSR can take you to any major cities in half the time as a bus or car. There are also bike sharing programs in major cities. You can pick up a bike from a station with that same card used on the bus or train. This is great for people who want to get some exercise or who don't have a license but still need to get around. Not to mention that all these easy ways to get around means fewer private vehicles and less pollution.
And while getting from point A to point B is a major part of our daily lives. Sometimes we need to stop and get a bite to eat. The weather here is subtropical, so it's warm for the most of the year, and we receive plenty of annual rainfall. This means Taiwan is a great place to grow many different types of fruit. For example, wax apples, star fruit, mangoes, sugar apples, and pineapples, just to name a few. Furthermore, the food here is affordable and convenient, not to mention delicious. There's a food stand on almost every street and street corner offering local delight. You can experience what Taiwan has to offer by visiting some of the famous night market around the island. I highly recommend you try it.
But Taiwan's most standout quality has got to be its people. When people travel to visit or live in foreign lands, the cultural differences can be overwhelming. But the people of Taiwan greet you with warmth, politeness, and a smile. Even if you don't speak any Mandarin or Taiwanese, they will try to help you. But it's not how they treat you that makes the people stand out. Taiwan is full of talented people who are able to implement and innovate. It is for this reason that many companies come to Taiwan for our technical prowess. These are just some of the things that I would tell anyone who are looking our way for opportunities. There are many things that make Taiwan stand out, and I really hope that people can appreciate all the things that make Taiwan unique and a great place to live.